French in top right-hand corner where you obviously see the pictures from Paris. And make sure that that's pinned on your screen so that way you see Kate and then you still hear me. I will turn my video off for now just so that if you get back to the black screen, then find Kate. So we are going to, we'll go ahead and jump in. We are in Saint-Germain, of course. We are on Boulevard Saint-Germain. And so this is, we're in this really cute little park, which we'll show you in a second. But this is this really cool piece that JR did. He, you might even see him lately. He did a really amazing piece out in the Trocadero of the Eiffel Tower. If you don't know who JR is, he does these really cool outside murals where he takes, basically blows up photos of people and he will put them, he's done them all over the world. And he did a really cool one of a little kid looking over. So it was an optical illusion. So it looked like he was peering over the wall at the border. And he did recently, or I guess not recently, a few years ago, he did a interview with Anderson Cooper on 60 Minutes. I posted it yesterday in the discussion on the event page for today. So go check it out if you're not obsessed with him after you watch that, like I am. He is pretty cool and pretty amazing and has a really cool philosophy of kind of trying to make everybody see others in the world as you know, we're all the same. We all have the same hopes and goals and everything else. And I think sometimes as the world, we forget that. So he's just really awesome. This is actually him. This is actually an image of him scaling over this wall. And so it's here and it's probably going to be here for a very long time. He did that really cool piece in the Louvre a few years ago that was on the ground, and it was for the anniversary of the pyramid. And within a day, because it's just paper, it's glued on, and within a day it started peeling up and people just started going and tearing pieces off, which was kind of his intention though as well. But he did say recently, I saw him on a live Instagram, that he said he's treating using a different treatment. So hopefully things last a little longer. So hopefully this will be in Paris and on this wall for a little bit. So we'll go ahead and jump on in. We are in the square Taras Shevchenko. and it is this cute little park here. And it actually sits where the former cemetery of Saint-Germain was. It was called the Saint-Pierre. I'm not really sure where the inhabitants of that said cemetery went to. I couldn't really find, but I'm assuming that they're no longer underneath this park, and not sure where they went. But inside the park, this was actually the cemeteries where they buried lepers and plague victims, sadly. But the name, it's named after that gentleman right there who was a Ukrainian painter and a poet. So he is standing there. It's a really pretty little red marble pillar that he's on. There's also a, right underneath where JR was, there's also a monument to a gentleman named René Leno. He is the one who actually created the stethoscope. You know, some of these things that you know, obviously we see them in our life all the time. Some of us frequently more than others lately, but somebody, you know, you just think these things have been around forever, but he actually was the one who invented it. And it came up because he was walking through the Louvre. At this point, the courtyard of the Louvre was still filled with houses. He was walking through and there was some sort of a small cylinder there. And these kids broke it and they put it up to their ear and they were running around laughing because of how it made the sound kind of echo and you know, blow up basically, you know, it was louder to them. And it was kind of exactly what he needed. And he was trying to figure out something for a while too, as he was a doctor. And so this was the perfect thing. And so he ended up because of this, then he rolled up a piece of paper and put it up against somebody's chest and realized that that even helped magnify the sound. So he created the stethoscope. You never know what you're going to learn. but the stethoscope is French. So next time, you know, you're at the doctor. This building right here, I have always been in love with this door and this building. It's got these amazing caryatides on top of it. It's absolutely gorgeous. It is the Society of Geography. Sorry, we're letting somebody in here real quick. And it is beautiful. I love the caryatides that are on here. It's just so pretty. And that door. There's quite a few different offices in there now. Not just the society. And then we're gonna head on down the street here. We'll hopefully get down there to Delacroix in time so they don't shut the door on us. Maybe they'll still be, because it said tickets were till 5:30 and Kate went and checked it out. But because it's the first free Sunday of the month for a lot of the museums, and it's the first one they've had since quite a long time now, maybe even, I don't even know if they were doing it when they temporarily opened in the summer. I don't think so. It's very busy and it's a beautiful day in Paris. So we're gonna walk by, of course, we'll see the three major little cafes up here that everybody knows. Looks like some people just got a little, says some Hermes shopping bags there. The first one, of course, is the Café de Flore, and it is this, actually, real quick, this little bookstore right here is absolutely amazing. It's all mostly, I think it's just all French books, but they also, which I love to go into, they have also really cute and amazing little gifts and cards and stuff, but I love that place. It's a really good one. Café de Flore, of course, was opened in 1887. We did walk by this on way back in, I think, December, we walked through here, but this gives us another chance to see it with some people here. Look, and there's lots of people. It's back, baby. But it opened in 1887, and it's, of course, named after the goddess of flowers and spring, Flora. And you could tell by up above, maybe when we get across the street, we can look back over and see all of the flowers that come from the flowers and the greenery that's always on top of there. So beautiful, such a beautiful place. People definitely have their favorites as far as the between this and Dumagot, which is of course right next door. But this was Jean-Paul Sartre's favorite. He set up here basically morning, noon, and night, all from breakfast all the way to dinner and apéro. He would sit here at Café de Flore. But there's people that you either are a Flore or you're a Dumagot person. I kind of prefer Café de Flore. Dumagot seems to usually have a lot more tourists, but I would also go to both of them either way. But there's definitely more people. There's lots of room there between the tables now. As usual, you sit down and somebody's, you know, it's that, there's that, if those of you that know, when you, there's a little bit of a dance that you do when you're sitting on a terrace and somebody is close to you on either side of your arms. There's times that your arms are actually touching and you're trying to lift your fork, and you almost have to get into unison with the person next to you. Otherwise it gets very uncomfortable because it gets, they really pack you in there. So Kate, we could head over down there to, head towards Delacroix. We'll come back up. We're going to end up here. So we're going to come back and show you, and hopefully maybe some of my favorite, the really handsome valets are going to be working out here. We'll come back and see this. It's such a beautiful day. It's going to be beautiful in Paris all week. Has anybody else out there already been looking for tickets? Trying to get getting back soon. I cannot wait. I'm counting down every moment of the day, 72 days to be exact. Oh, yay, Jennifer, that's awesome. June 29th, so exciting. I know I have a friend of mine that she and her daughter are actually flying. They leave on, was it Tuesday morning, the 8th? or Tuesday, and they arrive on June 9th. The day that it's open to Americans is when they arrive in Paris. So I'm so excited for them. We'll come back here. We did show this little park before, but I love it so much, we'll have to show it again. But when we walk by, I think it's after the church there on the right, Kate, there's some shutters on that building. You could keep going. Keep going. That building that kind of sticks out ahead of you. There's these, the shutters on the right have the cutest little, I don't know what you would call them. They are the cutest little, these little metal brackets that hold the shutters. And they're down right below the shutters. I'm pretty sure it's this building. We could, I think so. Yeah. So are we going to be able to see them? Okay. They're like little ladies. They're just the cutest things in the whole world. I love them. And you could catch them sometimes in some of the buildings in Paris. I absolutely love them. Some of them are broken off. Somebody probably tried to keep one, but they're just so cute. Look, and they just are like, there, I'll fix the little lady. They're just the cutest things. I love those details. Gotta love those details in Paris. And then we'll go inside the, we're gonna go try to get in there real quick. And then we'll come back out, Kate, to this spot. Because this place here on the left is a place everybody wants to live. And I found out who it was that lived there, and I'm so excited to share it. So we'll race in here real quick, and then we'll come back out, because in the very center of the Place de Fürstenberg is one of the installations for today, for the parkour. Is it open still? Look at Kate, she's like running. So this, of course, is the Musée de la Croix. And if you know, I'm sure you all know by now that he is one of my very favorite artists. He ended up coming and living here from 1857 to 1863. He came over here because he was painting the three amazing paintings that he did at Saint-Sulpice, and he wanted to be closer. He was getting older at this point, and he wasn't in as great of health. He actually said later in a letter to a friend that those paintings were going to kill him, and he did die about a year and a half after they were finished. But he actually moved here, in the back is the courtyard, which we will go and show you. We'll do a whole thing from here one day. But in the courtyard, it was a pretty big courtyard, and he had his atelier built there. And so he was able to build it to his exact instructions and exactly how he wanted. It's really cool when you go in there, because it's just basically this big open space with these beautiful red walls. But the floor really creaks, and I kind of love it when it does that, because then it's just, you know, it's just original, and it's still just amazing. But he lived here. He lived here with his longtime assistant, and I think she took care of him, Jenny. He left a lot of in his will. He left a lot to her. But he moved here later on. Another artist, Claude Monet, actually lived in this building as well. And then this straight ahead, Delacroix to the left where the flags are, and straight ahead, Frederick Bazille also had lived and had an atelier there for a while. So it's quite a few of the artists right around in this little section, because we are so close to the Ecole des Beaux-Arts, which we will see today as well. But after he died, the Society of the Friends of Eugène Delacroix came together trying to save it, to save the building. Later on, it went up for sale. And so they actually sold off quite a bit of the collection that they personally had to be able to purchase it. And then after four long years, they finally convinced the state to acquire the property and save it. And then in 1971, it was opened as the Musée Delacroix. And then back in 2004, the Louvre took it over. So the Louvre oversees it. And what is really great is if you go to the Louvre, save your ticket, because the same day or the next day, you could go into the Delacroix for free, just show your Louvre ticket. The museum itself is rather small as far as what you see inside and in the atelier. So it's not, you could definitely do it, you know, rather quickly. I could still spend hours in there without a problem. Because it is small, they change out the collection all the time. So it's one of those places that you could go every time you're in Paris and always see something a little different. So here in the center, this is a Place de Furstenberg. This is one of those iconic images that you see over and over again of Paris. In the center, it doesn't normally look like that, but this is one of the installations for the parcours. It's done with AA, which is the oldest French architecture magazine. And it was done with this group of three architects that they call themselves the Freaks. And I saw a photo just yesterday that there was more flowers. It's just now it looks like a lot of greenery. But it's here in the center. You've seen this, they've used, I think it was the Age of Innocence, part of that was filmed here. There's always something being filmed or photographed using this in the middle. It's such an adorable little, well, I guess there's some flowers on there. Idyllic little courtyard, and it's looks just so different and so quiet, you know, and it's so close to, but we're so close to Boulevard Saint Germain. Oh, they're like little bleeding. Aren't those like bleed? Oh, maybe not. I was thinking there was those bleeding hearts. But it's so adorable. And it's, of course, it's named after the, this is where I used to always get this confused because of the designer, Diane Furstenberg. But it is, it's spelled that way. It's Furstenberg, but it's the French way. So it's Furstenberg with the M in there instead of the N, but it was actually named after the Cardinal Guillaume Egan de Furstenberg. He was the abbot of Saint-Germain in 1697, and he was the one who actually opened up this little space. Uh-oh, where's Kate? He actually opened up this little space to connect it to his home, which is right behind us, which we'll go back out and see. But they changed it so it's the French spelling with an M, Furstenberg. You have that perfect, the wonderful little light, the lamppost. There used to be a really cute place here that used to get the just tiny, and all they had was choux pastries, like Odette near the Shakespeare and Company, and sadly it closed, and now it's like a little spice place. So, oh my gosh, how beautiful is that? So the building right in front of you, the big one, is what was actually where the Cardinal Furstenberg lived. It was the palace at the time when this whole area was basically this from here all the way down to the Seine. This was all this huge area that was over seen by the church, the Église Saint-Germain du Près. And so they had all of this area, and they had this palace built, which is absolutely beautiful. Now it belongs to the Catholic Church, and they have a school in there. So a lot of times you see a lot of kids coming out here when a school is in session. And it's so pretty with the brick. And you could sit like we'll go back when we go back there, the Bonaparte. But this building here to the right with the plant, with the greenery on the top is definitely like, it's just, Kate, can you walk around the other side of it? Cause there's like a little, gate, and you always want these kind of places when you see them in Paris, you always just, or maybe it's me, I always wonder who lives there. I'm like, oh my gosh, who lives in that place? It's so amazing. So when I was looking some things up, and I looked up this location a while ago, it was actually Victor Batard, who lived there. He is the one that designed the pavilions that were at Layal. So all of these always, our walks all end up getting tied together at one point. But he actually lived here. He was working, this was during the time of Haussmann and Napoleon III and the Second Empire. And he was, he did a lot of work for the city. He was in charge of the churches and quite a few other places. He just kept, they kept moving him along through places. And he was living here for a while. He created those wonderful pavilions that were at Layal that are sadly gone now. You can still see one outside of Paris, but there's a couple other buildings in Paris that look, there's the at Villette. If you've ever gone out there a few years ago, if you went out there to go see the King Tut exhibition, that was where it was. Right now they have a huge one to Napoleon going on. I think that goes until either September or the end of the year. I've seen both dates mentioned, but he did, that's now the, it was a basically a huge cattle, like they sold cattle and livestock, and now it is an exhibition space. So you could kind of, you could get an idea of what Layal looked like at that point. But my newsletter that I do every Wednesday will have a whole big thing about Victor and all of the different amazing things that he created. The Church Saint Augustin, which we will do in a couple of weeks. We will go there because it's inside. It's amazing. A lot of the churches that had iron structures, a lot of it was covered up, so you don't see the iron, but in Saint Augustin you do, and it's gorgeous. So we'll head out of here. When we walk down here to the right, Kate, tell me if that store, it's called like Dandy something. It's on the right, if it's still there. There's this pair of shoes in there that I've seen for years, and they look like Stan Smith's, but then they actually say like Rive Gauche and Rive Droite on them. And I they might be men's shoes. I don't know, because I think this is supposed, yeah, the Artie Dandy. Hopefully they've changed up. No, they still have, are those the ones in the window? I think so. I don't know. Kate's doing my shopping for me. See, there they are. Rive Droite and Rive Gauche. I really need those. I might have to do it this next time. Also, it could teach people how to say left and right. This is a really cute area. If you're here in January, when they do, it's kind of the interior design. There's like a week where all of the shops get really decorated and they decorate the facade. Ron and Debbie know that because usually we're all there together. But this is a really beautiful area because there's so many different galleries and interior design stores down here. It's very cute. And we're just like that right behind us is Rue de Seine. So you kind of get an idea, which we've been down here, not on this street, but we have been over here. Kate, did we go past number 12 on the right? Oh, I think so. And I don't think it's open. I was hoping, number 12 was open, but it being Sunday, it was a roll of the dice because it has this really cute little courtyard you could go into. I think it's there. It would be that green door on the left, on your left. I have another pharmacy. It's always good. The French pharmacies are like the greatest things ever. I just try to go in there and think of ailments that I could have them give me things for that might come up in the future. But number 12, sadly, when I'm in Paris in a few weeks, we will go to quite a few of these and, there's a really cute little place. Yeah, that was it. Tomats, that's right there. And it also has a really cute little courtyard. But coming up when we see number 20, on the right, number 20 is if you had listened to our episode we did about Natalie Barney, who was an American that came to Paris, She has a home, and we would just, I would just love to be able, I think I'll just, when I'm there, just stand outside till somebody opens the gate and sneak in. Inside of it, you would never know from looking at it from the street, but inside there's this huge long courtyard. And at the end of it, there's a Masonic temple. And it looks like a Masonic temple. It's got these big columns on it. Yeah, it would be hidden behind there. And it has these columns on it, and it says the Temple of Friendship over the door. And Natalie lived in a house that was inside there. And then, but she also had the temple. And so she would actually, she was like the lady of Paris when it came to the salons. And so she would have these huge salons that she did for over 60 years. And she ended up, everybody who was anybody was there. Every American that came to Paris had come there. She was good friends with Gertrude Stein and later Alice B. Toklas. She was quite the lady around town. She was a lesbian that basically, when other lesbians came to Paris, they said it was like the rite of passage to visit and be with Natalie Barney. And she was quite the character. She wrote, she was a writer as well. She had a really amazing, interesting life. So definitely, if you haven't heard that episode, check it out. And after this, I will post. And then if you want to send me your email, I have, and now Cheryl, it is 6 pages. This one this week I wrote yesterday of all the notes for today is 6 pages of notes so that when you go back, you could take it with you. And in it, I also have links to like the specific, if I mention one of the podcasts and anything else, I put some links in there too. So you go look things up. There's Kate. Hey, Kate. But there's tons of galleries down around here. Of course, it being Sunday, a lot of these places are closed. But it's still fun to walk around and check it all out. And Rue Jacob, which is where we are right now, it was got its name because Marguerite de Valois, who was the second, or the, I'm sorry, the first wife of Henry IV, towards the end of their marriage, when she wasn't having any children, and he was, Kate, look here to the left, is inside this courtyard. Did they take, oops. I'm wondering if they took, I read that they took the tree down that was in here. Is there a huge tree in the middle? No, how sad. There was this gorgeous, beautiful, tall tree. And I read that they took the tree out. So that's very sad. But she actually came over here and had a lot of this area. She had kicked out one of the churches and put in another church. And then in it was a altar to Jacob. And so that's how it got its name. Our Gimbel's creek getting crazy. Of course, here we have La Durée, which I'm sure many of you know. I think the poor Gimbel's going crazy. It's beautiful and very expensive macarons in there. And across the way is the Près, which is the, we'll give Kate a second here to get this silly.
Sorry, the gimbal's just stopped working. Sorry, guys. It won't reset. Come on.
Technology.
Yeah, sorry, it's one of those days. We'll get there.
Mercury's in retrograde.
Right, you know, I'm just gonna hold it with my hand.
Okay. Over to the other side that is the Près, which is a very cute little cafe and restaurant. And of course, on December 20th, 1921, when Hemingway and Hadley, his wife Hadley, came to Paris, they stayed just down the street at the Hotel Jacob. And they came here for their very first meal in Paris. They have an amazing duck confit. Duck confit is one of my favorite things. They have a really great duck confit. It's a really nice little place. Of course, every place that he went back then, it's a little fancier and a little bit more expensive now, but it's pretty great. La Durée always has the best windows. They're so pretty. There's a really cute, you go sit upstairs in this La Durée. It's really adorable. And you have to get some, I mean, the macarons I think are what, €3 a piece or so, something like that. But you just get a couple of them and it's definitely worth it. What a cute little pharmacy. I love this little courtyard right here at number 21. It was the home to Henry Boulard, who was a lawyer and a book collector. Looks like they're replacing some of the door, getting it cleaned up. But we will see today what I think is one of the best doors in all of Paris. It has the coolest knocker on it, or it's not really a knocker handle, I guess you would call it. I love this little place. One day that door was open and I poked my head inside there. We're going to kind of go, we're weaving in and out of some streets today. Because some down here are some of them. This is one of my favorite little streets, the Rue Visconti. It doesn't look like there's a lot to it, but this was actually in 1962, the artist Christo set up a bunch of oil barrels going across, blocking it. He was doing it in conjunction with another gallery that was here. He, you know, is the one that he passed away this last year, but they are wrapping the Arc de Triomphe. You know, he's known for his wrapping things in fabric, and he's wrapping the Arc de Triomphe. This September, it was put off because of, first it was put off because it was going to be in the spring of 2020, and then it got pushed off to because of COVID, but also because it was the time for the migratory time for a certain bird that actually stops and nests at the top of Arc de Triomphe, so they changed it. But this little street, I love this because it was at one point, look at how usually this little street's so quiet. There's a few galleries on here, which is perfect again, because we are next to the Ecole des Beaux-Arts. But this was also where Racine lived, the playwright, and also Renoir and Basile lived here. Alfred Sisley and Monet also had ateliers here, and also Delacroix. Delacroix also lived on Rue Jacob for a little bit. And then he lived here all before he moved to where the Musée Delacroix is. Is this actually opened? I see the lock. I don't think I've ever seen this actually opened, but this is, ladies and gentlemen, the smallest park in Paris. It's very tiny. And I didn't really, I don't think they just changed the name of it a few years ago. And I just always thought it was somebody's courtyard. It's actually a city park, but I've never seen it unlocked. Isn't it adorable? It is the Jardin Alice Saunier Sette. And she was, she used to live just right down the street. She was a politician. She was born on April 26th, 1925. Another lady to add to my list of my birthday, to add to every year to go visit. So she actually lived down the street. She was a politician, but she was actually one of the first women ever elected to be a dean of a university. She ended up later being the minister of the universities for France. And she, in 2017, it was just renamed for her. But she lived down here at number 5. Look at how I love these old doors. It's such an old little street, and you very rarely see anybody. You only will see a few people walking through. This area also, because it has so many galleries, this street and also another street we're going to go down is known for a lot of its primitive art they sell in the galleries here. It's just a very cute little quiet street that so many of the artists used to live. It's Delacroix basically bounced from, you know, this street, then he went to Rue Jacob, but then he moved to Place de Furstenberg. So he just kept moving up down the street. And now we're back on Rue de Seine, the much photographed little market that's right there. But right here, coming up on the right side, George Sand lived. She lived a few places. This isn't the last time we'll mention her today. George Sand lived here in 1831. And there's an amazing little courtyard coming up here. It's just one gallery after another here. It's especially in Rue de Seine. There's quite a few of them. But it's really neat when they do the design week in January, at least the last, I don't think they put them up this year, but they normally have these huge, gigantic lampshades that they string across this from buildings to buildings. It's really fun. Coming up here, this blow up pink thing is another part of the Parcours Saint Germain. And we are now on the Rue des Écoles de Beaux-Arts, which is this very, another kind of a little bit busier of a street. There was up on the right-hand side, there was the former Hotel Denise, which is where Jim Morrison stayed when he arrived in Paris. This is probably when he discovered the rock and roll circus, where some people think he died instead of his apartment over in the Marais, which we had seen before. There's another little wonderful place coming up here. Walks are so great because we could see what is opening and what has not opened yet. But the hotel called L'Étoile is up here on the left, and we'll see that because it has a sculpture of a ram coming out of it. This used to be where Oscar Wilde spent the last few moments of his life. He stayed here. While the little money that he had, he would go up to Café de Magot, and he would drink absinthe and stumble back home, and he would find letters underneath his door telling him to, you know, pay up or get out. But he kept, that was just his constant cycle of what he would do. He ended up dying here November 30th, 1900. So the last time I saw this, it was all boarded up. There's Oscar right there. It looks like it's not that's good, because it was everything was boarded up before. But that back then, it was the Hotel d'Assas. And it's one of the smallest 5-star hotels. For what you would pay for a night, Oscar could have probably lived there for 3 years. there's one of our JCDC. Oh, that one's adorable. And look, he's changing up his little star that he does there. Oh, and another one. I think he lives around here. So there's a lot of these in Saint-Germain. And if you follow him on Instagram, I could give you guys the link. He's posting these, tons of where he's putting these all over the city. There was something going on here a few weeks ago where it was actually another outdoor outdoor walking street art gallery. So there's tons of them. I love it. We saw these in the Parc Monceau last week, remember? And the little kids, little twerps had wiped some of it away. He just does it with chalk. Oh, look at that one. I love it. I need to see. He did a really cool thing for Notre Dame after the fire too. So now we're coming up, and maybe we could sneak into the courtyard. This is actually the École des Beaux-Arts, and that beautiful gate there. Look at how gorgeous that is. You have two busts, one of Puget and one of Poisson, up on the very top. Look at that. Nice job, Kate. Normally, you could walk in here anytime. Usually the entrance is over to the right. Oh, they kick us out. they usually you could go in there because it's actually a school. They must have kicked poor Kate out. But you can see from inside the courtyard, that chapel right there is part of the oldest part of the oldest structure there. And the facade is actually from the Chateau d'Anne, which is the chateau where Diane de Poitiers, the mistress of Henry II. That was where she lived. And they had redone the facade and had brought it up here to Paris and put it on the outside of the chapel. The École des Beaux-Arts goes back to 1817. It kind of took over where the Royal Academy had left off when that was kind of obliterated in the revolution. And so this is where, you know, they had quite a few different schools of, you know, painting and architecture and everything else. So this whole area is where all the artists were, of course. It'd be too bad we couldn't go back into we could see some of it from the street up here too. You can on Patreon weekends in September, the third weekend in September, my very favorite, you can actually go inside and you could go inside what is the Palace of the Beaux-Arts. It's absolutely stunning inside the ceiling. They have a huge amphitheater in there and has this amazing paintings up above. Okay, over there to the right, Kate, we want to go to that door. This is the greatest door in Paris. It has the greatest handle. Don't get yourself hit by a car though. Just before you even see the handle, it's pretty amazing as it is. And this is where Manet was born as well. And I love Manet. But we'll go over there and see that amazing. It was the Hotel Bressan. See, I mean, really, I mean, it is like the coolest. It's just, I love these things. They're so, if they were real, I wouldn't be so excited about them, but it's just gorgeous. And usually this gate is usually open. So you could actually just walk right into it. It's really gorgeous inside. It's so cool. I think they're just handles. Most of these in Paris don't actually knock. But Manet was born here in 1832. There was a printing press here for a while, and a bookstore. They all were in that area. To the left is that Paris perfumery that was done by Boilly. It is, you could get really cool gifts in there. They are very spendy though, but they are really gorgeous. It was basically one of the first perfume shops, not this exact location over on Rue Saint-Honoré, but it's a really pretty store inside and they have really beautiful gifts. That gate is just amazing. Up here on the right-hand side, once we get closer to, we're heading down towards the river. Number three was with the home of Alexandre de Beauharnais, who was also, you might know his wife, Josephine. Of course, we know Josephine from Napoleon and Josephine. I'm actually reading a book about her and because we're going to do a couple episodes of the podcast on her. You can't fit her just into one episode. Reading this really interesting book. He was quite the cad, not exactly the greatest guy. He died at the guillotine. He was quite the jerk. But we're going to head over here. Kate, if when you get down here, we'll go to the right for a minute. We'll go out to that island where the Republique statue, because there is another statue or another little piece of art out there from the Parcours. Right behind Kate is an adorable little cafe, the Café des Beaux-Arts, which is closed today. it's a great place that I will hit up a lot after going to the Louvre because they're just right across the river. We're close to the Pont des Arts, and that's a great place to get a little. Sometimes the only time I ever drink soda, and I don't know why, but when I'm in Paris, sometimes in the afternoon, I just really need an ice cold Coca-Cola after a long day walking and in the Louvre. It's just perfect sometimes. Also, I got another little bit of intel we walked past it twice back there, where the Palais des Arts folded. Very beautiful. They moved the little passageway there. So on the Pont des or the Institut de France, the instant present is already past. Ah, very true. But there's also out on the Bouquinese down the way, there was some more pieces of art added for the parkour. Some of them are actually done by students of JR. He helps out at one of the schools. We have, of course, Miss Republique up here. She's been covered in quite a bit of scaffolding over time. One of the apartments right behind her on the Quai Malaquais was being redone. And when I went to the amazing place called Fief and Co., he basically is, lack of a better term, we could turn around and go, oh, there's some over there. Oh no, that's Bouquinese. We could head back down the Quai Malaquais, past the school. He is, a lack of a better term, basically he does like architectural salvage, and he, oh yes, orangerie. Yeah, it's so delicious. He basically has this huge warehouse. I met him and was invited to go visit it. And his clients, he was telling me his clients are billionaires, not millionaires, billionaires. And they come to him to redesign or use these pieces in their, you know, palatial Paris, apartments. And at first I think he thought I was crazy, because I wasn't obviously anywhere close to even a millionaire. But once I was like, well, what's this from? He goes, oh, that was from one of Napoleon's apartments. Oh, that was from Diane de Poitiers. That was Catherine de Medici. And I was just dying. We completely geeked out for about 4 hours about history. And he just kept taking me through one crazy cavernous room filled with these items. And he was telling me at the time he was doing an apartment that was right there. And it was, you know, like just like $1 million job. They do reproductions of old pieces. He worked with Karl Lagerfeld on the Hotel de Crillon. He did some rooms in there. But it's just the most amazing place. I'm going to see when I am there, if there's a way that I could bring some people there. So when I'm there from August to October, I'm going to see, I will be doing some tours. I'll do some video tours still, but I will do live in-person tours. So here on the left is this, in this courtyard, this is the part of the Hotel Chimay that's part of the school. But you could see right there are some, the little partition one back where that column is, that is from the Tuileries, the former Tuileries. It got burnt down. You could see it there on the left. Oh, I love it. I would love that, to have that just in my yard. That's from the Tuileries. There's some other pieces in there, but this is all part of the school. When you go in there, you could go in there anytime. You can't really get back to this part of it when you walk in any day of the week, except for Sundays, apparently, into the courtyard. You could see quite a bit. You could just move all around to the right of this. There's another big open courtyard that has some pieces in it. There's a column there on the right. You could see kind of in the back. That's also from the Tuileries. But they do have exhibitions in here. They actually have one right now that's about Jericho. All of these, you know, all of the artists, basically most of the artists all went through here, whether they were architects or painters. Most of them went to the École des Beaux-Arts, unless you were a woman, of course. You didn't really get to go there. They only allowed a couple women a year. It was very difficult to even get in there. And that was even in the later years. But they have a huge collection because of drawings and paintings that were from those original artists. And these are all pieces from different chateaus around Paris that have come here, slightly protected. So pretty. This little street is also, George Sand lived right here, just right past this as well. She lived here with when she was dating Alfred de Musset, who we saw that sculpture of him in the Parc Monceau. He was the one that he was kind of going a little, he would have hallucinations and go a little bit crazy. And so he, that's the one that he went to Venice with her and had an episode, and she took, called a doctor, and then she had an affair with the doctor and brought him back to Paris with her. It gets a little crazy. We have that. We did an episode all about that. It was kind of fun. But we'll take a left here. We're on the Rue des Saints-Pères, and we are going to go over here and see. This is another place where you want to walk by every time you're there because it constantly changes. But up here, just down the street, Mr. Gustave Moreau, who, if you've gone to his amazing museum over on the 9th, if you haven't, definitely put that one on your list because it is just, he left his home and his atelier and his art to the city. And with, again, with instructions on how to leave it, he took, he, the entire place from like floor to ceiling is covered in paintings, small, large, every single size. I think it's the next street. He had specific instructions. He also like basically numbered all of his paintings and left huge notes. I love, absolutely love the facade on this building. This was added in the 18th century. The building itself was built in the 17th, and then they added that gorgeous railings. And this building over here to the left, the actor Jean-Paul Belmondo still lives today. He was the one that played in Breathless with Gene Steinberg. But the Gustave Moreau Museum is amazing. It's small. It's the one that has that gorgeous staircase, the gorgeous circular staircase that goes up. But it's really interesting. They have these, on the side, they have these little louvered display cases that you could just keep flipping through that basically have like a million sketches as well that shows off all of his process and as he worked on things, a lot of mythology and symbolism, and it's really cool. He did that really cool painting in the Orsay that he used Michelangelo as one of the dying slaves, the image of their face on the sculpture. So this, of course, is the Maison Serge Gainsbourg. And it constantly changes. A few years ago, you could kind of still see it around the edges of that black and white boxes. It was what they had on there was super, super cool. But this is where he lived at the end of his life. And this is where he died. And the front of it constantly is changing with different people coming and paying their respects and leaving notes and painting on it. The neighbors sometimes get annoyed, so they paint it over, and then everybody just comes back and adds back onto it. But it was just announced this year in March on the anniversary of his 30th anniversary of his death that his daughter, Charlotte Gainsbourg, who is a singer and actress herself, is actually going to open it. That green thing with the green kale or what it says coming soon. It's supposed to open in October, the Maison Serge Gainsbourg. It literally, nothing has changed from the moment he died. There's still cigarettes in the ashtrays. Everything is exactly the same. She's going to open it up and she's supposed to be putting in a ticket booth behind us in a parking garage, I read. And you could go in there and see everything. And then down below, downstairs, they're putting in like a place to do different little exhibitions. But it's gonna be really cool. One of my favorite things is that he had the very first glass-fronted fireplace. He thought it was such a waste of time to have to open the door to see inside your refrigerator. He thought it was such a waste of time. So he had somebody build him a glass fronted refrigerator. And so that's kind of cool that he has in there. There was a photographer that had come in here a few months before he died and took pictures. And Charlotte had let this photographer go back in a few years ago. And he went back in and took pictures. And I saw them in a gallery in Paris. and they had them side by side, and it literally is exactly the same. And it's really interesting. There's a lot of stuff in there. But it usually people come here and put their little notes and paint on the wall. So I will anxiously await. I'm hoping it does actually open in October. I can't wait to get inside there and see it. Okay, we could head back out to Rue de Seine, and then we were going to end here, but we'll take you back up to the Place Saint-Germain, and we'll show you that stuff that we raced through to see. This little street itself, if we had kept going, there's some really great doorways and everything. We'll do that a different day. I wanted to take us down one day down by the Orsay. I love the Orsay. Next weekend, I'm super excited because the Louvre is open. We tried to go to the courtyard and share all of that stuff with you before. But back when we went there, I think it was in December, it was all closed off. So we are going to go back into the courtyards of the Louvre, and we'll tell you all about all the amazing things on the outside of the building. And then we'll go over to the Saint-Germain-l'Auxerrois church, go inside there. We'll go visit those two places and around there. So I'm excited about that. And then when I'm in Paris, I will definitely take you inside some of these museums and some of these places to show you. And I can't wait. You have all these, I just love those courtyards. There used to be this really adorable florist right around here, and they closed. I think it was right there. They closed up, which is kind of sad. And you could go take a left, and then we'll just head over. We'll head back down to Bonaparte. This is where the former convent, and later it was taken over when Marguerite took it over and gave it to a different religious group, thinking that was going to be her fast track into the good graces of heaven. And then it is the medical school. We actually, now we're on Rue Jacob, so we will actually walk by the hotel where Hemingway stayed that first night. It's still open. It's still a hotel. They used to always tout that they had this little pictorial display dedicated to him, and it's literally like one photo. It's like a little frame with a bunch of different photos of different people, and it's one picture of him. Which is kind of interesting. But Rue Jacob is a lovely little street. Life is definitely coming back to Paris. And I was just chatting with my dear Sylvain at Levant Comptoir this morning, and because I have some people coming into Paris this week. And so I wanted to, they wanted to go by and see Levant Comptoir. But the Levant Comptoir de la Mer that is in Odéon, that's on Rue de l'Odéon, is not open yet. But they have another location in the Marseille Saint-Germain, and that is open. I love this building that has these statues up there. And here is the hotel. Hotel d'Angleterre, Jacob. It inside is actually, it's definitely a little fancier than it used to be. But the staircase where they said he said it wasn't in very good shape. And it was basically a trap for drunks, because they'd come back late at night and be drunk and basically, fall or down the steps. Such a cute little street. But the Marseille, Levant Comptoir in the Marseille is open. So that's exciting. You could take a right here, Kate. I think this is we'll just come around a back little way. Yeah, we'll come around the back little way to Place Saint Germain. There's right here on the right where all this construction is, was this very authentic, amazing, wonderful French restaurant. I wonder if it's, I'll have to see if it's still, it's still there. It's just covered up. And then of course up here is the, what is it? The Relais Interco, I believe it's called, which they only serve. It's up there with the red awnings. We'll take a left there, Kate, at the end of the street here that goes into, I think it's Apollinaire, Rue Apollinaire, but it only serves steak frites. That's it. It's incredibly popular. If you want to go get there basically right when they open for dinner, I think like at 7 o'clock, if you like steak frites. I've never gone there, actually. I need to still do that. But I do hear from people that it's pretty great. That is it right there. And that's it. You can see, actually, do you see at the end of the street where all the greenery is? That is the Café de Flore. But we'll take a left here. And coming up here on the left where those red awnings are is one of the favorite places of a lot of people, Le Bonaparte. It is a fantastic place. I love going here, especially on a sunny day. You get the sun and you're sitting there and you're looking up at Place Saint-Germain and you are the Église Saint-Germain and you get to hear the bells. Also for a bonus, this is really a strange thing, but one of the servers there looks like Napoleon. Like he has the same nose and everything as Napoleon. And I was sitting there one day and Dory Greenspan, the amazing American cookbook author, she lives in Orion. She was there and I've always loved her cookbooks. And I usually never do this cause I get way too, shy to do it. But I finally looked over and said, I was like, hi, you're Dory Greenspan. And sat there and talked to her and her lovely husband for about a half an hour. And they were so, so nice. And I pointed out to her that the server looked like Napoleon and she was in hysterics. She thought it was hilarious. And she has since sent me a message when she's gone back there. She sent me a message one day that the Napoleon lookalike at Le Bonaparte is still there. So we did see this when we walked through in December, but now it's all green. This is the Square Lamprecht and it is in the middle of this right here is a sculpture by Picasso. The city wanted to dedicate a monument to Apollinaire, Guillaume Apollinaire, who was a poet. He was a critic and he was a friend of Picasso. When Picasso, we lost her, hope she comes back. When Picasso was accused of stealing the Mona Lisa and Apollinaire, Picasso kind of threw him to the street and Apollinaire actually spent about a week in jail. But Picasso was later asked to create a sculpture for them dedicated to his friend. He had quite a few different ideas and kept presenting them to the city and they didn't like any of them. So finally he was ticked off and just gave him something he already did, which was that the head of his lover and muse, Dora Maar. So hopefully Kate comes back here. I could turn my video back on just in case. But inside the park is, around it is some pieces that were from the original Abbey of Saint-Germain that actually stood there on that street that we walked down, the Rue de l'Abbey. And so they actually, some of those pieces are in that park. So there is one on the back wall that has some writing on it. I was almost to the point of trying to hop the fence in the dark of night and doing a rubbing because you can't see very well what is written on there because some of the words are pretty faded away. But did we lose Kate again at the very end, just in the perfect timing? We'll give her another minute to see if she comes back on. But it's a really cute little park. I love to sit there also in the afternoon on a sunny day. Although I can't really, the medication I am on that was giving me to literally keep me alive. I can't even really be in the sunshine through the window. It kind of makes me all red and splotchy. So I think we might have lost Kate. Oh, well. Hopefully she pops back up here in a second. But that whole little area, the Place Saint-Germain, of course, has some of the stone sculptures that they also have in other places in France. There was the gentleman that did it. They're all colored. Like, he did these stones and painted them all crazy, really, really bright colors. He did it there, and it looks like kind of like a little a person. It has the way he sculptured or put the stones together, I should say. So I think we might have lost her. Well, we'll give her a minute. Does anybody have any questions? Are you dying to get back to Paris, as all of us are, now that the world is opening up? It's so great. Anyway, I guess maybe we kind of lost her. It's when this happens, it's always right at the very end. It's kind of perfectly timed. But so I hope next week we get to see you when we go back to my favorite place, the Louvre. We'll go around the outside. Angela, November and April. Oh, well, I'll see you there in April. I don't know if I'll be able to. I think I was thinking if when you mentioned November, but I don't think I'll be able to extend it. But I will be there till the end of October, from mid-August to the end of October. So if you need some planning help, I instantly this week have about 10 people I'm helping plan their trip. It all happened literally in basically the same day. So once everything was announced, everybody's excited to get back. So if you need some help planning some specific special things that most people don't know about, definitely let me know. And then also I will be there giving live tours. Most of them are pretty much private. I kind of don't do a lot of them where it's multiple people. So it could just be just you, you and whoever's with you, or just you on your own. And my tours always end at depending on where it is, but most of the time it's in around Saint-Germain, and it ends at Le Vent Comtois de la Terre for a glass of wine. So most other tours don't get you into one of the hottest, coolest places to go in Paris at the end. So I would love to see you if you're there then. So let me know. I will post a video for this afterwards and all of the notes if you want me to email them to you, because it is rather large. Instead of posting it is always, it's very long. So yes, Jennifer, Le Vent Comtois is always, they don't even take reservations. So it's always full. The restaurant itself, where the sit-down restaurant, there's always usually a line to get in, but now because everybody has expanded seating and they'll be able to keep that, they actually have more spots. So hopefully, I'm sure they're going to keep that through the summer. So you'll have more of a chance to get to sit there. Also, the secret thing is Sunday nights. Sunday night dinner is when I first explored Comtois. The very first time I went there was in the fall of 2018, I think. I was staying right by there, and I would walk by and see on Sunday evenings, it wasn't packed with people. And so I would get a table. And that's when I first found out about Le Vent or Comtois. And so Sunday was always kind of the magic time to go. And then you could, once you do that, then you explore all the other places next door, the best Le Vent Comtois de la Terre. This is a commercial. So anyway, thank you guys all so much for joining us today. And hopefully you will join us next Sunday when we go back to the Louvre and to the Saint-Germain-l'Auxerrois, which has a couple pieces from Notre Dame in there that we'll get to see. So thank you everybody so much. And we will see you hopefully this next weekend. Bye.